Hi, I'm Justin Lang. I want to welcome you to this, a special edition of PLSNtv. We're taking a closer look at some of the aspects of Super Bowl 47's halftime show featuring Beyonce. We've got two special guests with us on the line. George Peterson, our fellow editor from Front of House magazine, joins us by phone. He shares a little bit of insight on the sound aspect of the show. Yes, I know we talk about lighting and staging and video on PLSNtv, but George Peterson has some interesting observations and some thoughts about what happened during the Super Bowl. Now, our fellow editor, Jacob Coakley from Stage Direction magazine, joins us on Skype to talk a little bit about his thoughts and what he noticed about the show. All right, so we've got George Peterson, our fellow editor-in-chief of our sister magazine, Front of House magazine, on the line with us. George, thanks for joining us here on PLSNtv.
Hey, thanks, Justin.
So I hear you had a chance to watch the halftime Super Bowl halftime show yesterday.
I did catch part of it. It really was quite a spectacle. Pretty amazing video stuff, pretty amazing lighting stuff, pretty amazing pyrotechnic stuff, and I guess there was audio too.
Well, we wanted to talk a little bit about the audio since we're doing an all-encompass thing here: the lights, videos, staging, sound. Tell us a little bit about what you thought about the audio portion of the halftime show.
Well, from what it looked like to me, there was looked to me like a pretty typical lip-synced video performance with part of Beyonce's live mic being used for ad-libs and for little intro bits and for her to say a couple of things. But I think that really what most people heard, at home, was lip-synced.
So you don't think this show was live?
No. It's really not a slam on anybody. Mm-hmm. It's just trying to get a really people in the home listening audience are really used to hearing something that's really amazing. They're really, really an amazing, absolutely incredible sound quality, a perfect mix. And chances of that happening in the rushed confines of a Super Bowl halftime show are pretty unlikely. And I really think that the best way to deal with that is to pretty much lip sync it.
Okay. One of the portions that we noticed looking through back over the halftime show was when Destiny's Child came on with Kelly Rowland, Michelle Williams singing with Beyonce, was that part of their mic, those two mics seemed to be out, not as potted up or full as Beyonce's. Does that help believe that it wasn't lip-synced?
I think it, what we were seeing was just a combination of both. It's it's pretty much the same thing as when people sing the national anthem at the beginning of it. Everybody's saying, wow, every performer always says, no, I really want to sing it live. But, when the pressure's on, you're really better off going with a lip sync performance.
Talking a little bit more about the lip syncing, I'm a lighting guy, obviously. Does the lack of move, I noticed during the show that she was moving a lot. And from what I understand, my limited knowledge of sound, that's why I defer to you. Does the lack of movement or her overabundance of movement and trying to sing at the same time, does that lead to lip syncing then? Because I've noticed that she wasn't singing as much as possible,
this is one of the problems that comes up in, quote, modern concert, quote the word modern concert production, is that with so much emphasis on dancing and movement that people really tend to move more towards having lip sync segments of the show, and they're really in real life, there are very, very few performers that actually can do really strenuous dance maneuvers and actually pull off a recording quality vocal performance.
Okay. Now, looking at the halftime show, what kind of troubles, what kind of problems do you think that the sound guys could have with an event like this?
Well, the main problem that crops up, and certainly they have a team of experts really working on this, is just the incredible amount of wireless and RF that's going on with press coming in for the Super Bowl from probably 100 countries around the world, local feeds, network feeds of not only wireless microphones, you have field microphones, you've got the people that are getting comments, announcers that are getting comments from the sidelines. You have on-camera mics. You've got foldback feeds that are going to announcers. To announcers that are on the field, as well as in-ear monitors going on to the performers. There's just an absolute incredible amount of wireless audio going around during the Super Bowl, and coordinating that is really a Herculean task.
How much RF signal do you think is flying around the stadium, you know, in the middle of this show?
In the middle of the show, still there's quite a bit going on. There's news media are trying to get interviews, you know, from the press in the locker room. They're using wireless mics for that. There's commentators on the side of the field. For Beyonce herself, and as well as the dancers in her troupe and such, the people that were performing on stage, the guy that came out with the guitar that had it was shooting out Roman candle balls. Each one of those people needed to have an in-ear mix that was also wireless at the same time. So in addition to anybody that might have actually been performing part or possibly even all of their performance going through a wireless microphone, you also have a lot of wireless going on in terms of people having earpiece mixes to keep them in sync and let them know what's going on. So coordinating that is just an amazing task. And I think it's every year, to the credit of the audio Super Bowl team at every level, they really have to do an amazing job in terms of coordinating all that wireless and making sure there aren't wireless dropouts and there aren't people stepping on different people's frequencies and such. And that's probably the most amazing thing I ever see at any of one of these big events like a Super Bowl.
So speaking about a large event like this, how does the on-field mixer, the mixer front of house, how do they deal with this? They have 8 to 10 minutes to set everything up. How do they deal with something like this in that short amount of time frame and all of these frequencies, all of these in-ears, all these wireless microphones to deal with?
Well, that's a tough act. Fortunately, when you're working with using a digital console, you can have various presets and snapshots set up in advance. So you can pretty much hit a button and pull up anything that you really need, as opposed to the old days of analog consoles where you'd have to physically have to go, for every different setup you'd physically have to go through and turn dozens if not hundreds of knobs and faders to get them in the right position for the next act to do a switchover. So a lot of it was really just taking advantage of what digital audio has to offer in terms of resettability of consoles, and that has a lot to do with it. But certainly there's not much time to do it. They pretty much get a couple of a short short channel break in terms of blasting out and getting the gear out, getting everybody out. And, you know, there's a lot going on during that. In fact, I imagine without very careful coordination, the whole thing could erupt in chaos, but it looks like it came off pretty well.
I have to agree there. Switching gears, one thing that everybody is talking about, the mass media, it's a huge thing on Twitter, on all of our social networks, is the 35-minute blackout from the Superdome losing power to half the stadium. Any ideas what you think might have caused the outage?
Well, it was definitely an overload somewhere. Probably in this case, we can't really blame the audio guys.
Trust me, we'll try to.
typically, the lighting feed is pulling a lot more juice. Of course, trying to reset something like that can be kind of a mess. And of course, when you have various types of like sodium lighting and such, it's going to take a while. Even if you turn it off, it's going to take a while to be able to restrike that stuff. So and that's after you find out what the problem is. And I think the blackout that occurred really took everybody by surprise, and it wasn't like they had an immediate contingency plan or had somebody standing around saying, well, in case we pop half the breakers into place, this is what we're going to do.
Well, what's funny is the San Francisco 49ers have had this happen twice to them on Monday Night Football. I think one this season and one last season. So maybe it's an omen for the 49ers. Well, Mr. Peterson, thank you so much for joining us here on PLSNtv, talking a little about the Super Bowl halftime show.
Hey, really appreciate it, Justin. Anytime. Thanks a lot.
So let's go ahead and start with our editor, Jacob Coakley from Stage Directions Magazine. Jacob, thanks for joining us here on PLSNtv.
My pleasure.
So I assume you took some time out last night to watch the Super Bowl halftime show?
I did, in between the blackout and the San Francisco 49ers losing it for me. But yes, I did manage to check out the Super Bowl halftime show. And frankly, I really liked it. I enjoyed it.
Well, you mentioned a good point there. Before we get into the halftime show, what do you think happened with the blackout there? The half the Super Bowl or Superdome losing half its power, from what I understand, all of its power, and running on emergency light. What do you think happened there?
I have absolutely no idea. I haven't read any of the statements that have come out. I've just read the brief ones where the NFL has said that they had nothing at all to do with the halftime show. Sounds like just a circuit breaker somewhere got tripped for the actual Superdome itself. I have no idea what caused it or what it was all about. So I know less than nothing, but I don't know what happened. I wouldn't begin to guess as to what it was. If I was going to get really conspiracy theory on you, I'd say that someone in the 49ers organization was just like, you know what, I need to give my guys a break, so we tripped the power. But that's probably not really true.
Well, you know, that brings up another interesting point. This is not the first time this has happened to the 49ers. Apparently, Monday Night Football game, the power blew or the lights went out at a 49ers game.
At Candlestick Park last fall, not 2012, but in 2011, I think, or was it this year in 2012? In any event, it was 2011 or 2012. Yeah, the Candlestick Park, the power went out. That might be conceivable as a conspiracy theory, except for the fact that Candlestick Park is so old that it's completely understandable to me, with all the Monday Night Football demands, if something just tripped. PG&E does their power, and they had a whole breakdown of what happened and what substation blew and something like that when that happened. So I don't think that it's anything to do with a conspiracy theory on there. But you're right, it is odd that the 49ers got it both times.
Well, you know, I'm a Baltimore fan. Since my Redskins weren't in it, I have to go for Baltimore. So, yeah, I'm going to call it a conspiracy thing, man.
But there was definitely no conspiracy there at the end, though, when he didn't get the holding call, so the goal line stand. So,
well, there was that 108-yard running back, you know, right before the power blew. So
that's true.
Well, let's get back on track.
Yes,
talking about the halftime
values.
Yes, yes. So let's talk a little bit about the opening. I was blown away by the pyro and then her being silhouetted and then silhouetted again with the video in the background. What do you think about that?
She was still, it was, I was just watching it, and it, what occurred to me was that she was, she wasn't lit. She was backlit and silhouetted for close to 2 minutes. I was looking at the timer on that. So it, was, it goes about 2 minutes before you actually see her in that halftime show, which is frankly pretty ballsy. I mean, you've got Beyonce, you've got a big star, and what you're going to do is you're not going to show her for 2 minutes. And I think that was, I think that was a really brave choice. I think it was a great choice with the pyro and the fog and the silhouetting her, simply because, I mean, you knew who it was, or at least you had been told a lot before it was. So just the idea, it was just a very dramatic, very powerful way to open the show, I thought, as well. And the video wall, going straight from the huge pyro into the video wall, I thought that was a great choice, too, just to really ramp up what they were going to do technically and blow you all away. I liked it.
Now, some of my notes here that I have, the limited information that we have so far, VRE, video equipment rentals, brought in the video aspect, doing all the kaleidoscope work. Now, they didn't do the actual media, from what I understand, but let's talk a little bit about the video work in the stage itself. The content is obviously the first thing to talk about, but the video wall or the panels, that was amazing. I've seen it before where the wall actually lifts up behind them. Ask me, it kind of reminds me of those backwash things on an aircraft carrier. For half a second there, I thought Beyonce was going to take off and go flying through the audience.
That would have been interesting. Put her, like, had her flying around like one of those cameras they have through the stadium. That would have been a really interesting choice. I love the video monitors coming up out of the ground. I had never seen that before, to be perfectly honest. And then when they started coming up, I actually missed them coming up. I just saw them up. It wasn't until they retracted that I saw that they hadn't like flown them in or just kind of popped them up like a toaster. And I loved it. I thought it was a really great, really great use of the medium and a really great use of the physical stage that she was on as well. I will admit my jaw hit the floor on that. I thought that was pretty amazing.
So speaking about the stage, what did you think about the silhouette or the outline of two dancers or singers? I would assume Beyonce being
right,
outlined behind her. What did you think about that?
Yeah, the two faces silhouetted with each other. Well, it always begs the question, did you see two faces or did you see a vase in the middle of them?
I saw two faces.
I liked how they did that. What I felt was really ingenious about that is that it did give them kind of a nice wider area at the bottom of the stage that they could use, but it also gave them a nice little kind of catwalk runway that she could walk up and down through it. And it didn't create a proscenium per se, but they didn't worry about doing it in the round. It created a very vertical element on the stage so that you can have the lights behind her and you didn't have to worry about spreading out all those Sharpies throughout the stadium. At least I take that back. I think they were Sharpies.
No. I've got confirmation here. Those were Sharpies providing the backlight, creating those amazing aerials there.
Yeah.
They were actually two rows of 60.
Say again?
There were two rows of 60, 60 up in truss, 60 on the ground, providing that backlight aerial effects.
I thought that was really great. I thought it was a very concentrated way to put a lot of lighting power in one area as opposed to trying to ring the stadium with them. I think it just created a better visual for that. I mean, the other thing, of course, is that it gave the audience space to kind of flow in and walk or not dance or whatever they did around the stage. This is one, I'm sorry, I'm going to hijack this for a second here. This is what I don't understand about the Super Bowl halftime show. Where they get these fans to rush in ecstatically and rush in on the stage as if it's this like spontaneous moment of pure fandom. And when a lot of these people, I'm sure, I really don't think they're actually fans. I think they're hired or they're dancers or something. So I guess my question is, why do they feel that we need those people there? That's my question. Why do we have to even have people for this show?
Make it look bigger. Now, you've got to be honest with me. If somebody came up to you and said, you know, you're actually attending the Super Bowl and said, hey, you want to go on stage, be a extra? What would you say?
Well, this is the thing.
Exactly.
I don't think I actually approach people who are attending the Super Bowl. I think those are people who are specifically hired, paid or not, but are specifically brought in just to be fans for that.
Well, trust me, that's a gig I want.
Well, fair enough. And this is pure, I hasten to add, this is pure speculation on my part. I don't actually know how they do that. I just... all those shots of the crowd rushing into the stage, my immediate thought is, yeah, the stagehands did all that work 10 minutes ago, so.
Well, I still haven't found out exactly how many carts were used to bring in the stage this year. From last year, I know there was 57, and that was a pretty huge set.
It was a pretty huge set.
In comparison, looking back between Madonna's set and Beyonce's set, I'd have to say they're pretty close to about the same size, so I would assume around 60 or so carts were used again this year.
I would imagine it's the same way. I mean, you got to figure this stage. I mean, the stage has to fit on the field, and those dimensions aren't going to stay the same. And I don't know that they could find any more room backstage to store all that stuff during the production. So I got to imagine you're right around the same size in carts. And also, while we're talking about carts and actually putting the stage together, I mean, it makes things easier when you're on artificial turf as opposed to grass, because you don't have to. I don't think he had to lay down any special equipment that the stuff had to roll over. Maybe I'm wrong on that, but I know in the past when it's on grass, they do. But the other thing is we talked about the video wall coming up from the base. How they do that on a cart, that's something that I would like to know more about, because that was pretty impressive to just get all that stuff in and have all that automation and gear in that already. I wonder how much of that they have stayed. Like, I wonder what they do to stage it and build it on the carts and what they have to do once they get it all out there, if they're just plugging in power and data through, or if there's more that has to happen once the carts are actually out on the field.
Funny you mentioned that. This is just a lead up. This special edition of PLSN TV is just our speculation, like you mentioned, about what we saw as viewers and throwing our professional slant on it. In the March issue of PLSN, we're going to have an expanded coverage. Michael Eddy, one of our good writers, is currently finishing up the piece and is going to be having an in-depth, so stay tuned.
Excellent. Well, the other thing that seemed to get a lot of comments from me, and I thought it was an ingenious bit of stagecraft, but some other people didn't like it. It was definitely kind of a weird reaction, was the quote-unquote hair coming out from the side of the stages at the end of it, with the drapery and the cloth billowing from the fans, and then having like facial features and hair kind of lines projected onto it. I thought that was a really ingenious use of stagecraft and a really ingenious use of fabric. But when I put that out on Twitter, a couple people mentioned that they thought it was just creepy as all hell.
Speaking of Twitter, I assume you're following the hashtags going around during the halftime show?
I followed 2AMLX. That was pretty much it. I didn't actually see any of the hashtags that were going around about the show. I saw you mentioned one this morning, though. So what were some of the hashtags? I'll go look for them.
One of my favorite Twitter quotes from, I think, just a spectator was, someone forgot to put the fuse in it leading up to the blackout, talking about Beyonce's song, just put a ring on it. So speaking about the sound aspects, I know Stage Direction Magazine covers almost everything in the theatrical side: sound, lighting, staging, costumes, makeup.
It's true, we do.
Now, what do on the audio side, how do you think the Super Bowl halftime show went?
Well, I think it sounded great. What I heard sounded really good. Now, of course, there's the controversy or the unknown as to whether or not she actually sang or was just lip syncing.
Well, in your professional opinion, what do you think?
You know, I was looking at it, I couldn't tell. I mean, obviously she had an open mic for the comments. I did notice about halfway that, again, this is I'm not timing anything, this is my own impressions. I noticed about halfway through the first few songs that she did before the rest of Destiny's Child came out, I believe. But the first few songs, there was hardly any singing whatsoever. Mm-hmm. She was doing a lot of dancing and a lot of call-outs. But in my brain, I was like, oh, yeah, of course, it's really easy. You can say you're not going to lip-sync if you're not actually singing anything. And that always is the big knock on these kind of spectaculars, is that you get these people and they're being asked to dance around and to be as physically active as much as they can. And so, of course, you're going to lip-sync because you're just going to track it, because there's not going to be any way that you can do all those dance moves and still carry a tune and have enough breath to sing.
Well, you bring up a good point there about the movement and the lack of singing. I too noticed that, and I am a profess that I am a lighting guy. I have no idea about sound, but I noticed as well that she wasn't singing as much as we thought she would. So,
right.
You know, does that...
She picked up the singing in the second half. I will say that. She definitely started singing more in the second half of the bit, and there was more, and there was definitely less movement at that point. As to whether or not it was real, I mean, sound guys out there now are the best in the world. Well, obviously, if you're going to do the Super Bowl, you're going to get some high flying guys to do it, and the amount of gear and the amount of processing that you can put on anything, you can make any live sound almost studio quality at this point in time. So, like, I don't think you can say sound quality wise it was obviously tracked, because you can do so much now with live sound. But having said that, I don't know if some of her little trills or her improvisations, I mean, maybe she was just lip syncing to all of that. I don't know. I guess I would like to actually hold out a little bit of hope that our performers actually do sing live. But, you know, maybe that's just a little misguided of me, and I'm just a little too bit of a naive theater guy. I don't know.
Well, let's talk a little bit about the other aspects that Stage Directions talks about. Some of the costuming. Well, lack thereof in costuming. What did you think about some of the costumes, or again, lack thereof? That
I don't think there was any lack thereof. The I mean, it was a completely, I won't say PG, maybe PG-13 rated costume. I will say that when she started stripping things off in the beginning of the show, it was one of those like, huh, moments, and definitely made me think of Janet Jackson, wondering how far or where she was actually going to go with this. But I don't know. I mean, the costumes, the thing about these costumes is that, like, I joked on Twitter that the biggest winner out of the halftime show was the knee-high black sock manufacturers, because everybody seemed to wear those. But I don't know. I like these. They were functional. They let the people move. They showed off their bodies. What I did notice was that some of the other two girls in Destiny's Child, I mean, these aren't, I'm sorry, I forget. Is it Carly Rae Simon who does Call Me Maybe?
Carly Rae Jepsen.
There you go. It's Carly Rae Jepsen. So she's like, what, 19?
Somewhere about there, yep.
Somewhere around there. But like Beyonce and the other two ladies in Destiny's Child, they're not 19 anymore.
Yeah, Kelly Rowland and Michelle Williams. Sorry.
Right. They are mature women. And so the costumes that they had, I thought, were appropriately revealing, and also at the same time very flattering, in that they revealed enough to make things racy, but also enabled them to, like, they didn't have to worry about being Victoria's Secret models. Like, a little bit of cellulite was not going to be a problem. So from that angle, I mean, I thought the costumes were racy, appropriate, and flattering, and let them move. So I don't know. Kudos to the costumers, I suppose.
Well, Jacob, thank you so much for joining us here on this special edition of PLSNtv. It's been a pleasure talking to you about the Super Bowl 47 halftime show. So this has been a special edition of PLSNtv, taking a look at Super Bowl 47's halftime show featuring Beyonce. I want to thank you, my fellow editors, Jacob Coakley from Stage Directions Magazine and George Peterson from Front of House Magazine. You can check their websites out at stage-directions.com or fohonline.com. Thanks for joining me here in this special edition of PLSNtv. You can learn more about the Super Bowl halftime show in our March issue, where we'll be featuring a expanded production profile thanks to Michael Eddy. Again, thanks for joining me here on PLSNtv.